drafting some of the issues we're kind of discussing. Now, has anyone seen this particular tabby apple? It's not widely known. These are owned by us, but this has been around for a little while now, a couple of years, and it gives some very wise advice on hand events and being the K-Fox, particularly when it comes to an untrusted source, and it will bring it into your environment. The recommendation is to use IDF for importing different machines into your environment. The reasons for not trusting all the DBKs and the NX files that you bring into your own environment should hopefully become apparent as we go through this talk. Now, has anyone seen the virtual disk format technical white paper? No? It hasn't actually been updated in a little while, but the information is still relevant. It has descriptions about the layout of virtual machine disk files, disk descriptors. Has anyone seen inside a small DBK file disk descriptor? A couple. If for instance, I've lost you might have snapshot chain, failed to connect properly, you had a story rail issue, and you're stepping into recovery, you may have to delve into specifics of the script of the folder. Most of the time, you wouldn't be aware that what appears to be one virtual disk is actually composed of one or two or more files due to boundary SSI. What we see here is a basic minimalistic form of a descriptor file. In this case, it's vertical one of the NDK spec. It's got no parent snapshot. It's got a great type of monolithic flat, which means that the data is actually stored in another file on the file system of the CMS or NFS. And right below that, we have the extent descriptor. And the interesting thing here is that that path is not one usually associated with the virtual machine. It's actually one of the host files. In this case, it's the init table file that contains the services to start up in the ESXi shell. Thankfully, there's no direct control of the content of the descriptor file through the VC client or through the API. Otherwise, there can be some serious problems. And there was also some further protection in a file that ETC VMware configures. And I don't expect many people to have seen this file, but I'm aware that some VMware customers have actually taken customizing them when it stops virtual machines from powering on with their particular naming standards. It has a set of rules, but this rule in particular controls the kind of VMDK paths that are installed within a VMX file, and it limits it to a set of prefixes like a scuffing device, it's got a bus number in its file, and it only allows the VMDK file to be located under VMFS, and the path can't start with a slash. So relative file paths work, but they have to be under VMFS. The creation of disk descriptors is usually subject to application controls. Consume data store space, you need to be able to browse data store content in order to create a new virtual hard disk. There's some basic controls that you can easily wrap up in the vCenter role. Now, one thing to be wary of is that the content of descriptors can be tampered with if your users are able to upload up through content to a data store. Or there's another option. Now, hopefully, you've ensure that some of your virtual infrastructure administrators who have access to upload and download files from your VM data source. But even if you take that precaution, is something I reported to VMware last year. Until recently, including in the most recent versions of vSphere, ESXi accepted descriptors in any VMDK file. Usually there's a hyphen flat or another scripture, and I caught some slap up at the guy's fault. And the content that I can control by this operating system, it accepts as a descriptor. So the issue here is VSphere and SSI mishandles user data, the data that is controlled for the guest operating system. It treats it as a disk descriptor, which is supposed to be a sensitive configuration file, and that allows a virtual machine user, and there are some prerequisites around having some particular roles or privileges assigned, but it allows for them to exploit this mishandling, even in basic proportions like within the data store access, have been taken. So we'll just run through a demo. And in the context of this demo, the user's got limited access to virtual infrastructure. There are a number of virtual machines running on this host, but this is perhaps a simple way of blocking out shared infrastructure. This could be a user environment where folders are being used. In this case, it's just the host and permissions being added on machine. The user in this case has to be sent to the virtual machine power user role. Not virtual machine user, just the power user. And for the first example, it's a fairly contrived example, but in the SXI system, there's a banned text message today. If you have a login warning, you might have had pause to change it. Now, virtual machine harness capable of very right, they're very right devices. We could, if we could get out of the virtual hard disk, cause significant damage. We could link the configuration, or we could destroy data on the host or run the data stores that the host is mounted. But I reckon we could arbitrary code execution on the host. So, this is just a basic Linux virtual machine. Nothing particularly special about it, sitting on my data store. Now, there is a requirement to exploit this vulnerability that the user who's accessing the virtual machine has the ability to do some privilege operations with the guest operating system. In this case, using sudo. And what this is showing is the content of the first sector of a virtual disk that we have to find here. This is not good, this is a second virtual disk file. And what we're doing is we're writing text onto the descriptor straight into that first sector of that backing disk through the guest operating system. So I'm going to hit once. Normally your descriptors have more content. And just to prove that we created a temporary file, and we'll copy it down. Now, the virtual machine is still running. What we're going to see here is that the virtual, the flat NDK file doesn't appear as a double virtual disk. We don't have that option. But that's quite a simple remedy. There we have the content from the disk, and we're going to shut down, so we'll desist on here, isn't it? Now, since we shut it down, the lock has been released on that flat NDK file. There's nothing preventing both the descriptor and the backing of the flat NDK file, the back references, from being used by the same DNA at the same time. So here we've seen that we've been able to select the flat NDK as a disk descriptor. We've been able to attach it to the virtual machine with our virtual machine power user role. We're going to power it up. And in this case, we're just going to redirect the contents of the new disk, this third disk that we've added. And this message is the message of the day from our SSI system. So we prove we can pull, bring that off a host that the virtual machine should have been configured to access. So now that we've been able to access message of the data from the system, let's see what else we can do. We're going to take that descriptor we created earlier, we're going to modify it, and this is a much more sensitive file on the host system. The two characters that start there are the access limit, rewrite. So we're just going to copy that descriptor back to the first sector again of the second disk. That's going to be the flight dependent data file. So what we've actually got here is a shell script. Now if we can write content back into it and the host executes this shell script, then we're going to get code that we inject with the RSC running in the SXR shell. Now it just so happens that this is a service helper for the SIM services. It's one of the very few script files that are people script files that run after the boot on a regular basis. It's every 5 minutes. There's a health check done for SIM services, and it actually runs script content in this file under the check SIM SLP resident pool. So we have to be very careful when we're doing this, because we are effectively working with a raw disk. And if we try and copy down the wrong number of bytes, we don't have pre-existing content. You know, we don't have a file that's composed of something that's copy our content and some stuff that we apply that overwrite. So we need to make sure that we put back a copy that's 100% compatible with the remaining content. We can see here that we've actually made a system change to that file. So I didn't actually get a chance to swap screens quickly enough. After this virtual machine shut down, the code was actually executed. But what we find out there is this is just the slash temp location on the SXR host. Oh, sorry, just this is actually the slash root. We are going to see that timestamp be updated, and this is proving that we've been able to run some code on the running log schedule and is there running code. We've created a file on the file system. If an attacker were able to leverage this, they would be able to do all sorts of other things. It's running as root, you can see that the username associated with that file is root. The SXR shell is effectively a single user account environment. But you'd be able to run many diagnostic tools, you'd be able to take control of virtual machines. So this is a serious issue. Now, on the board for this talk, one thing that I wanted to discuss is the security white paper, the security SXI hypervisor white paper. Is anyone familiar with that? I'd suggest going and taking a look. It's been recently updated, I think it was January this year. It stuck around for quite a while, and practically all the content remains true for all previous versions of SXI, at least back to DLI3. But it has been updated a little, and it's got some fantastic information about a raft of things. In terms of this virtual disk escape, the important principles that we can expect from the SXI are spelled out here in relation to isolation. Now, it says that we can expect that a virtual machine will not be able to access resources that an administrator has not assigned to it. Now, it's not saying that it's going to protect SSI version of Shanon on the disk that was a configuration mistake. So this is an important thing to keep in mind as an administrator system, that any virtual device that you connect to a virtual machine, or that you allow someone to delegate someone to connect to a virtual machine, if they can control the host resource that's backing that virtual device connection, they can cause all sorts of issues. It's not a level of, like, you know, a number of the other types of isolation of has strong controls around it, and an administrator can't change the behavior around, for instance, the entering or exiting of the hypervisor context switch. But for virtual machine devices, it is something that an administrator can do. It's how the administrator has been. That's why the content of the configuration files, the MX files and BNDK files, should be limited to general administrator. Now, in terms of what I've shown here, there are actually a number of items in the hard drive, most specifically restrict data for web, as the name of the hard drive items. This is a very effective control against exploitation of this kind of issue by virtual machine users. Basically, if the virtual machine users don't need to have access to view, upload, or download files and data store, remove that access. Just applying default roles and privileges and adding rights until things work is, you know, one way to go about things, but definitely before putting systems in production, run through the targeting device and pick up on particularly the restrict data store and disconnect devices items. And what I suggest as well is if there are unused devices, floppy drives, CD-ROM drives, etc., in your template, that you remove those from your templates, particularly if you accidentally allow a virtual machine user to then change the backing file for one of those devices, even if they can't add a new device, you know, apparently a new CD-ROM drive. If there is an issue with CD-ROM drives, or there's a way for a user to control the host resources that are backing CD-ROM, it's not going to be the first place a virtual machine user isn't going to be able to connect them to it. So it's not needed. Disconnect those devices and remove them from the networks.
Can I summarise my understanding of what you were showing us there? So you were showing. So my understanding of what you're showing us was somebody that is a power user is inside a virtual machine, hacking around with contents of their disk, which is their virtual machine's disk, and because they're a power user, they had access to directly browse files in the data store, browse the view, and connect something to the virtual machine that kind of wasn't intended to be connected to it.
Exactly.
Right. And then because of that, inappropriate use of the file in the data store, they didn't have access to both the host and, you know, the access to the host, the access to everything else. And so, and that's, is that right?
That's right. And there are a number of privileges that are associated with data stores, and in some cases, some of those privileges will be appropriate, others definitely won't be. So, being able to upload content to the data store will allow users to introduce the same content that we monkey around with writing description into a flat file. They'll be able to do that directly and not even need to do much more than upload a file attached to the virtual machine and away we go. So we can go through if there are any questions on other parts of the argument, but I'll sure.
So potentially this could be a liability. Potentially this would be a liability where if you did a say PTP conversion for a VDI implementation, that the user's privileges would be carried over from the physical station and give them enhanced
possibly authority. levels, or at least having users associated with visitor roles that will limit privileges and still a more appropriate set of privileges depending on the resources that they have in the virtual machines. And ask for whether that does SAP.
So, there'd be more around not so much malicious intent that someone's put into that, but say an administrator's desktop has been carried over into the environment.
Potentially, although in that case, the content of the virtual disk the content of the administrator's workstation is then usually encapsulated by a peer to peer tool. Now, peer to peer tool that had no errors in it will create a valid descriptor as a safe descriptor, and all of the users' content in the file will be encapsulated in a flat .pdb file. Hopefully, the tool is able to pack it up as an IDF for important environments, which is even safer still. So I'm not aware of any PDB tools that can this kind of mistake, but having said that, if the PDB tool puts in a register in the one environment, and maybe that PDB machine is then imported into another environment, or moved from a safe environment to a production environment, and that is done by picking up and copying roles and moving roles and re-registering the next roles of any of that loss. It is important to be very careful about where those DNS community cat holes are stored after the PDB process is complete, and that users don't have access to our privileges, that don't have access to modified content before it comes into the environment. That's a point where the other thing to keep in mind as well is if you're using things like NFS shares for your data stores, if other hosts, their recommendations are on present the storage for hosts that require it. But if those NFS amounts are made as an accelerator on a wide subnet, and that doesn't effectively limit to 100 years the size of the cluster, maybe there's some room for some growth. If someone's able to mount that NFS data store, maybe change to a file and then power on that version sharing, same sort of effect.
So that's avoid the common methodology of image onto a terabyte drive and then carry it off to a new location.
That implies a serious level of trust of virtual infrastructure administrator of whoever's giving them that particular engineering. If CDNS is a wonderful way to get large desktop images into an environment, the caveat of what we went through at the start is fairly clear that data format needs to be carefully sanitized before it's involved into the process.
We had exactly the same conversation with a number of search providers. Based environments, particularly the email director was one I saw a lot. And if the service provider allows a customer, any customer, to upload essentially an untrusted, unknown virtual machine to the environment, the email director allows you to say, we'll quarantine that, don't turn it on until something's been done with it, but most of them didn't bother turning that on. So this is kind of a consequence of saying, let's bring in an untrusted machine, and the same thing with the NFS. Now, if you want to step outside boundaries and say, it's not just a data store, it's also a file share, you can provoke some supply chain issues.
Absolutely. Other questions?
So, you were saying before that you have more trust in OBF export, so that VM you just created with that malicious MDK file, you would export that as OBF that's sanitized?
It does. And in fact, the OBF format As we get on to good news though, which is being close to bash this issue. I'm sure everyone was happy around Christmas time when it came out. It seems to be that the end of the year is when everyone's pushing to get everything out, and also everyone's going on leave. So this may have done the queue administrators right up if they should send it over the December, but it's been out for about 6 months, or over 6 months now. The other news is that the config file, the config rules file that I mentioned, is in an easy to understand format, it's a simple text file. Administrators are able to go in there and add additional protection or change the protection mechanisms in there. VMware have fixed up some issues in that file that led to this vulnerability. So just by finding patch, you know, you fix config rules file, but administrators are able to further strengthen in there. And as I said, ODF is, well, certainly for now appears to be a lot safer for import and export than of any of the native formats. And that's across hypervisors. One thing we haven't discussed here is what happens to other virtual machine formats or using other hypervisors and other import export formats. And ODF is pretty much the top of the list, in my opinion, for safe formats. And I guess the point I want to end on is that trust is absolutely important, and trust is actually a byword for compromise. If you trust someone, you accept that they can compromise you. So before trusting an individual, before trusting the system, before trusting an interface, it's important to realize that by trusting, you're allowing them to compromise you if they choose to, or if they are themselves compromised. I think we put our version of infrastructures and so much debate and so much work so well out of the box that we forget that there are a number of security considerations that are required. And I think system trust boundaries are a big one. We can expect the hypervisor to keep virtual machines relatively well isolated most of the time. But what happens when we have a management network? Do we allow normal users to gain access to their vCenter or vSSI host management network? If we go to the hardware level, we'll see that we're in version still going to be access to those management network interfaces. Not every environment does that. Also, the level of trust of VI users required for many virtual systems is quite significant. If you've got administrators that take care of your host environment, your vCenter environment, and your tenants or your internal customers or your external customers' virtual machines, that's right. I mean, you've only got one trust level, and you trust your virtual infrastructure administrators not to compromise those because they're the ones that are supporting it. But if you split up responsibilities a little, and if you've got a separate team that's responsible for administering virtual machines and has no access to against the hosts, this is a way that by splitting up that responsibility, you don't consider the trust boundaries and the system boundaries in detail, there may be possibilities for this sort of compromise to happen. And unfortunately, I think, and products like VDA Director and VPAC and all that help by moving multi-tenancy question one step out, but thoroughly dealing with typical multi-tenancy issues and also insider threats. If you have a disgruntled admin or you have someone who isn't in the organization manages to get access to the systems, it may not be as achievable as we might hope. Absolute deep defenses become available. ESXi systems effectively are a low manager. We don't have endpoint security usually on these devices. There are some integrations on, I think some of the APIs that can't deprecate it. But we consider that if you can break into an ESXi host, there's not much in there that will defend you further from further compromise. One option is by layering it out and putting other systems in front of it, and you need to ensure the security of those further systems as well. But hopefully, we will get some more maturity across
was going to make the exact same point about, I'll be aware here in the room, so. But, I would agree 100% that, don't give people access to these centres if you can possibly avoid it. And that's exactly what all these self-service tools and methodologies are about. One of them is to get people off. Tools are meant for a trusted back-end guy, even though they've got roles. You don't need to be a back-end beast here administrator. And the other is to address, malicious machines coming in from anywhere, is people setting up catalogs to say, this is a machine I want you to use. Do what you want with it, but it is a starting point. That's what they all learn, exactly the same points.
Do you think that you get from having a pre-canned service catalog that's got optimised, secure, hardened machines, you get so much benefit by putting in solutions that do offer service catalog and offer cloud provisioning rather than, hey, I'm consuming infrastructure, I'm going to a back end management system to do it. You've got to expect that there are areas where it's not necessarily going to protect against a fat finger or malicious administrator.
Is that a plug for cultural, organisational happiness? Is that security defence against malicious administrators?
I think you need to carefully consider what we can do from a network security point of view and boundaries around there. System boundaries, what we do with communication, limiting user access. Because having one office block, well, that's my virtual infrastructure, and that's licensed with administrators, and that means that it has to be 25 people because, two of the people take care of the virtual desktops that hang off that MVP center, and, we've got the virtual service, and we've got Linux support team, and we've got API guys, and we've got some storage guys, we've got access to the back end. That's a convenient way of facilitating operations, and, this is just one more console view, and I need to be able to see everything. But there are security implications for that, and thinking about virtual infrastructure and separation of virtual machines and hosts, and what the tools are in the environment, such as having direct host access compared with getting access to a reasonable server, and whether or not they should be on separate networks. And, this is all sort of right advice in the hardening guides around separating networks and using host-based firewall rules, etc. But it's not necessarily commonly followed, and particularly when it comes to the insider threat and large groups of administrators.
Yeah, I was also going to say about capability too, so something that occurs to me that wasn't mentioned yet is auditability. So have people using proper identifiable accounts to do these things and make sure that you have your logs directed into places that you...
And that's a good point. And
compromise. Because most people, and I don't know if you're going to talk about this at all, but most people don't look at where the ESX logs go. And if you've got a machine based on SSD cards or whatever, they don't go anywhere persistently. So you need to think about, well, if something does go wrong with a trusted person, if I have a bad day and I'm going to bring down the corporate world and, if I go nuts, at least if all other mechanisms fail, I have an audit trail to go back and say, well, that's where the issue started. They're all the points that Nate went to after he went nuts. And so,
that's what that also, and in terms of detective controls as well for this kind of issue, and not making them our control, we say that there are some unsupported methods of getting them rid of log files through syslog services. William Lane's got some log posts on how to configure it.
I inside the computer. Inside the computer file, could you possibly jail cell people? Just so they can, like a pretend root, so to speak.
Oh, okay.
So they don't actually have privileges on root.
Like Chandra? Well, and this comes back to the security architecture white paper. It's a effectively single user environment, and the ESXi shell compared to ESX Classic is realistically just a set of SSH shells and other utility programs that run a Linux compatibility layer. It's not a full-blown operating system, and it was a VM kernel under it all. Unfortunately, all the tools for doing highly privileged things with that VM kernel are available through that shell. And the VMX process that starts running the virtual machine and switches the hypervisor on and allows the guest to run, that is effectively running as the same user as everything else, which is appears as root. And you know, there is a conceptual debate about whether or not that's really root or whether it's a less privileged context that the bare kernel supports from the shell. But effectively, when you can access arbitrary blocks on anything that stories that comes through a bare kernel interface, effectively it doesn't matter whether or not you have the privileges of the bare kernel or you've got effectively a root in the SSI shell. You still don't have control. And unfortunately, user permission, but I haven't tested this thoroughly, but from some of the information I was seeing, may not be on it, and in particular things like access mask and preventing write access by not permitting a user or a group or others to write the file doesn't always work. There are processes there that can write the file anyway, and effectively under certain Linux configurations. That's true of the UID0 account, that it doesn't necessarily need to have permission by a file to go and write to it. It's the same thing in the SSI shell. Good question.
So who was the person who discovered this?
Good point. I made a discovery independent of a team in Germany who made a similar discovery a number of months beforehand. The guys published a blog series at insinuator.net, and their articles are called "Baby Case Like the Building," which is interesting because if you spend any time looking at VMlog files, it's usually the last line of a VMlog file is that the building is like the building. So a little bit of an intro there. They published some results there. They had some slightly different formats. They were able to access raw devices, which with certain formats, I was able to access some files that they weren't able to access. I became aware of the research and got in contact with them. One thing that wasn't clear early on is whether or not arbitrary code could be executed without forcing the host to reboot. And their contention was that they could make a permanent modification to the boot bank, which is and the backup boot banks. Now, if you use auto-deploy, you're not going to be able to make a system change, but if you've got a local cache copy of your boot bank files, which the base boot is from, or you install it on a local device, you can make a system change and reboot. It was only after going through a few different angles that I found, hey, there are script files in the SSI host that run and we can time it and we can write a change to their data code if you want to have to reboot the system. Certainly administrators are going to know if a host goes offline, comes back online unexpectedly. It's not a sign of maintenance mode if it didn't have a shutdown host and a power on host. The event logs and it just went down and came back up. That's something that's usually an operational alarm. This is what I demonstrated here is a little bit more serious. There's some VSAN logging with the adding of a device chain or changing device backing, but that might be lost in normal user activity. The rest of it, unless you're monitoring the VMware.log file of the virtual machine, which is an unsupported configuration still, I think. But if you're not monitoring that, then that attack might go undetected. But it's patched now, so keep up with patches.
How often do people, should people be patching their hosts?
A lot more often than they are. Earlier this year, I attended the offset conference up in the Gold Coast, some other research and some other vulnerabilities that have since been fixed. And does anyone want to take a guess at how many ESXi hosts, or ESX or ESXi hosts, there are exposed on the public internet? 10,000? 1,000?
15,000?
It's about 100, well, at the time, about a period of 3 months, over 115,000 have entered a number, I think it's 11,000 businesses.
You saying like the management interface?
The management interface.
Exposed?
Yes.
It's crazy. Hold on.
I'll be back in a few minutes to close the point.
SSH?
Yeah.
On?
Don't show us one. So while Shanon's taking the world, I think some of the basic principles are pretty clear. It's keep your eye on the patch reports and the vulnerabilities that get reported. I think my answer to how often would you patch it depends on your risk profile of you as an organisation. You know, what's exposed to how many people, how close are you to an edge? You should always know. You should always know where, you know, what level you're at, what vulnerabilities of or what, you know, errors in, you know, the important thing that you don't patch it by the system.
You might have a breach problem, right? You have to start figuring to the end.
Yep, but the knowledge is key, right? So you can choose not to patch your systems as long as you know your systems, who has access to your system, and what the updates are about. They might be about instabilities, they might be about features, they might be about vulnerabilities.
There's the VMware Security Advisory. This is a madness. You know, I suggest subscribing to it. It comes out about vulnerabilities that are disclosed. It's usually very accurate. Allows to make a proper risk-based assessment of how bad is this vulnerability, how bad is this vulnerability to me. If it sounds bad, definitely look at getting a patch in the environment. VMware provides security only patches as well. That's something that not all products do. So life is really made as easy as it reasonably could be for administrators to get up the patches.
In the room here, how many people have systems running ESX 3? Anyone? Or 4?
2.5.
Right, yeah. So we still come across the customers running ESX 2. Plenty of customers on 3. So there's a long tail of systems that don't get maintained a lot. And sometimes for other reasons, and sometimes just because they keep working. So there are things that need to be.
And if you want to know exactly what that looks like, you can just take a copy in there.
Yeah.
So I use a website, Shanon, which does a report of basically everything that addresses the common protocols. And you know, if you expose your system on the internet, it's probably in a database somewhere. But I think they count themselves as the world's largest online collection of data sets. It's a lot scarier, for people who think they're quite trying to come on the internet and not publicize that it's not going to be hit. People scanning all the time, this just makes it better. I'm happy to get to that. I mean, great questions, but I'm sure everyone's saying for it here.
Cool, yeah, so I mean, I'm going to ask Shanon some more questions at VBs. We'll be there. It's Cooper's Inn, which is on, where are we going now?
Down the corner of a little long style of exhibition, so just up north, up the road with it.
Yeah, don't worry, just follow us. All right, well, thanks for coming, guys, and don't forget, we've got the next meeting in September, coming to the meeting on announcements. We'll get an email to register in the next few weeks.
Awesome. I hope you guys come along with that session. We've got some really cool messages that we've been talking about internally for the VM world, and that's I'm sure you expect anyway. So hopefully see you all there. And see you today.
Thanks.